pleasure to come here. And the topic is kind of a hot topic, but I would be happy to answer any questions you have anytime. Just raise hand. And I just hope you enjoy the topic. Okay. The problem in the deep learning is really hot right now. But interestingly, that there's a lot of vulnerabilities in the deep learning systems. And most of the vulnerabilities comes from the strengths of the deep neural networks. So therefore, we're going to look into this, how deep learning works, how neural network works, and what are the problems that are generated from that kind of complex network structures and complex learning process. And then we will talk a little bit on the state-of-art mitigation techniques that people have been studying, including my group. And then we will talk about the privacy risks in this area as well. I am actually more a system researcher. I do privacy research primarily because it's interesting and because also I can get funding to fund my system research. So because it's harder to get funding for the system area. So I do this so that I can fund my systems research, okay? So, but I am looking at things more from a system perspective as well, okay? So first thing I want to mention is that all the machine learning systems, they are actually hot because companies think they can make money. So what they do is that they are actually releasing all the complex machine learning models as a service. And then people can pay to get a prediction result. And then they are, because they are bigger companies, they can collect a lot of data, retrain the model, so then and publish the model as a black box and for users to actually use to access it. And this is going to be the trend because all the car companies doing the self-driven cars, they also need to share the data about the road. And then they can actually have a richer and more accurate prediction. So this is going to be the trend. Now, if you look at this as a trend, then look at what are the problems here. So we're going to look around. First thing, I want to just give you a peek on the problems, and then we talk about why the problem occurs. So if you are self-driving cars, and if the camera actually sees a stop sign, but if the system are compromised, then this stop sign can actually be turned into a 100 speed up limit, and trying to tell your car to speed up. And because your system is compromised, it's auto-driving, and so things may get really bad. Now, how these things could happen, and that's what we're going to talk about today, okay? First, in order to understand how these things could happen, why it's so easily to happen in the system, I want to talk a little bit on how machine learns. So if you look at a learning, you have a bunch of training data. Let's say we are using image, because these are one of the easiest things people are using for most of the deep learning toolkit. And then, but it doesn't matter what kind of machine learning model you use to train, at the end, you're going to get a model. The model is actually a rule, a set of rules. And saying if is this, then is that. So there's a set of that kind of rules. Describe what your learning model is. And then you take this model as black box, turn it as a machine learning as service. Then you build the API, so then users can remotely send the queries with your example data. And then the prediction API would send to the black box and getting the result back. The prediction result would send back to user. So this part is public. And this part is privately trained, privately tuned, and the model is also black box to user to the API. That's state of art. Now, how on earth you don't have access to here? Everything is private, and how they can actually utilizing this simple public API to actually launch attack. And that's what we talk about, okay? Now, before I talk about that, I want to talk about how machine learns. First, when you are looking at a supervised learning, then what it means is when you train the data, you know what is labeled for each data. You just want a machine to learn. If I have 10 labels, then take a look at the 6,000 images. Try to differentiate among these 6,000 images, who are belong to the label one, who are belong to label two, and find this discriminating features, then you can actually help the new images who machine never seen before to identify which of the 10 class this new image belongs to with the highest probability. That's typically called classification. Now, if you have a linear classification problems, that means you can find a linear separator to separate these two set of problems. Then it's easy. It's linear. Now, if you have no linear problems, then finding this decision boundary becomes a little bit harder. Now, today, how machine learning algorithm does it, over the 30 years research, what they do is basically saying that to handle linear part, we use a linear SVM. And the linear SVM try to find the largest a margin. And then in the largest margin, cut in the middle. And that is your decision boundary. But if it's nonlinear, then they're going to have to figure out some transforms to transform this nonlinear space into a linear space, stretch the curves into a line, and then using linear SVM. So therefore, traditionally, you already have a lot of kernel transform. Take this thing, transform into a higher dimensional space. This curve becomes a plane, linear plane. And then you cut the space. And that's where you can calculate the separators. And that's a decision boundary. Now, if you have a line like this, you transfer each point into a high dimensional space. Now, you stretch this red one into here. You stretch this green one into here. OK, now cut is linear. That's all the traditional machine learning doing that. Now, deep neural network, they just do that much better. So they don't need you as a user to select kernel function. And they can automatically learn and find the linear separator. Okay, so that's actually what the deep learning does. So the goal here is that they add many layers of neural networks, iterative learning this process, and try to transform things, and using a lot of hidden features. And those hidden features is actually a discriminator across the set of classes you want to learn. But you have to give the training data set with a fixed number of classes. If you say, OK, all these images is 100 classes, then this whole thing is tuned by understanding all the images that are in these 100 buckets, which one I should throw it in. And they all learn that. If you say, I don't have 101, just the whole world is just 100 things, then just learn that. So if there's something like beyond 100, they will make mistakes. They will make stupid mistakes. Okay, but that's a state of art. Now, the question here is, in the early days, machine learning using shallow learning, like SVM, logic regression, and naive Bayesian, and Bayesian belief network, they are all shallow learning. And even neural network, they use a very small number of layers of neurons to learn, and a small number of layers to iterative learning. Only after ImageNet, which shows if you use a large amount of data, you use very deep layers, keep increasing layers, then you're actually beating the human capability. Because if you use a human to identify images, look at the image, say which class it belongs to, then humans' error is around 5%. And then once you are having the layer way higher, then machine can learn faster, more accurate. So that's made the entire machine learning and AI revamped. And everything now, we can relook at this whole thing now, because they're hot now. Because you use big data, you can power this whole thing. Okay, so that's where it stays. Now, how they learn, how neural network can learn. Basically, you take an image like this. Most image is RGB image. So you have red, green, and blue. So therefore, you have three-dimensional images. So take one image in, they cut it into a three-dimensional RGB image. And then for each dimension, they're going to decide the neuron's size. You configure your system. Even you have TensorFlow, you have to configure it. If you don't configure, whatever the default you use. Okay? Now, depends on the neuron size. Suppose here I use a 32 by 32 resolution images. I have RGB, I have three. So there I have three. And then for each kernel, I'm going to say I'm going to use a 5 by 5 pixel little matrix as my neuron. Then you decide this is your neuron size. Then I'm going to look at three kernels and 5 by 5 a neuron size. What is kernel? Each kernel is a one kernel transform. I just discussed with a linear separator, you don't need a kernel. If you have curves, you kernel transform. Now here, neural network, they can use many kernels. They don't use one, they use many. So you can say, I'll set three kernels. Then you have a three kernel independently learning this image. Okay? Now, how do you cut the neurons? You cut a neuron by 5 by 5 and do another 5 by 5. How the neuron will correlate? Overlap. You overlap neurons. So it means you cut a neuron first here, and then you do another neuron just with one bit, one layer difference. Just do this stack on it. So because there are lots of overlapping, then if you use neural network to learn, those overlapping allows you to learn the common features. They link. Okay, so that's how they learn the whole thing. Therefore, if you look at this, one simple image, if you are looking at how they learn, basically, they take the product, taking one kernel, which is 5 times 5 times 3, and then you are getting 75-dimensional dot product. And for this entire matrix, you take the kernels. Kernel is W's weight. If I have a 5 by 5, then I have another 5 by 5 matrix. 5 by 5 matrix is from the content, 5 by 5 matrix from my kernel initial input. And then I do this multiplication between this, I get a single value. Now this multiplication like this. So X is my neuron, W is my kernel, and the B is my bias. I add a little bias. Okay, you can initial that to be 0, then you don't have bias. And then you do this, you get a generally 1 value. Because I'm stacking it, so therefore, even though 32 by 32, I probably ended up with 28 by 128, another matrix. So you're just layer by layer doing that. And if you think a 28 by 28 is too small, stack on zeros, then you make it bigger again. That's how you learn. Now, how do we learn? This is a formula explained like this. So because W is 5 by 5, 25 elements, then you have 25 elements here. And X also 25 because I have a 5 by 5 neurons. Okay, so that's how you actually multiply. Now let's look at the neural network, how they learn. Once you see the one neuron, how they compute, then take each object, you have a lot of neurons. Second image, a lot of neurons. Third image, a lot of neurons. For each of these neurons, we actually compute, right? Each image, you divide into so many neurons, and you compute. And then what your goal is, you gave me a label Y. I want to know the prediction all the way finish my entire layer. The first prediction value of the label, is it close to Y or not? So this is a prediction with a vector of probability. And then the probability will be compared with this initial true value, true label. If the error is very big, okay, compute W. Because W is our kernel, we initialize it. Now next one, recompute W. Update W, initial value, and change it. So the goal here is every time I do the W change, I don't want to change too big. Therefore, you set a learning rate. So this is a learning rate. So when you turn on the TensorFlow Cafe, if you don't set your learning rate, they give you a default. And that learning rate can be tuned. Different data sets are different. Different problems are different. And if you don't know how to tune it, you're ending up with a bad accuracy. Okay, now with this learning rate, and then they will say, okay, every time you're going to use the derivatives about the WJ, and you are going to actually add a learning rate as coefficient, and then you're going to modify the previous W using this value. And then you just keep doing this slowly, slowly. And what you do here is, here's my initial point. Every time I change a little, change a little, change a little, change a little. Now the goal is, since your object want to go to one particular class label. Suppose I only have two class labels. Then my entire space, the W is going to work towards whatever the label you belong to. If I have a two label, then I have two peak on the mountain. So I'm going to walk around toward this peak because actually my label belongs to here. So this W change is slowly going back to here. And if it's going here, then I'm going here. Doesn't matter where you start. The W is slowly working and finding place to go. And that's where attack happens, actually. Okay? So that's the process, how it works. And because you do this way, then when you do prediction, it's a number of rules. The rule also going this way. Okay, the rule also doing this way. That's the reason, because it's an iterative learning process. The rule is iterative learning your new sample by trying to walk towards the correct place. Okay, so that's actually how it works. So the goal here is if you have a training model, you have a training process, you build a model. And the model actually is taking a new example and taking the function, generate a bunch of probability. Now, if the total number of class is 10, you generate a vector of 10 probability value. Each probability value belongs to one particular class. So if here is my data, then I put in a 1, I'm getting this probability vector. Then you can see 1 has 84 probability belong to 1. The rest is very small probability, still have a little bit. So it means machine doesn't know exactly you're absolutely 1. They know roughly, with a higher probability, you're 1. That's how machine learns. Now, this entire vector is open in the air, gave to the user. So because this whole vector is given to user, attacker can use that too. But if you say, let's don't give user that, but application developer, application user, they want to know that. They want to know how much confidence you have. For this particular image you have never seen, then you predict as 1. Then you say, 84%, I'm confident. So therefore, user want to see the entire vector too. So that's why today machine learning is giving that to user. But because you gave that to user, attacker has that too. They're going to manipulate that. Okay? So the entire attack is attacker going to change this probability to make this not as 1, not as highest. Just changing that. They will try to change that. So we'll see how they do it. Okay? So now let's go back to the deep learning service. So this is a user who used the model. This is the data who trained the model. This is private. And this is public. So now, where is a possible attack? Everywhere. So in the private training process, the internal people can do attack. So if I am the data, training data, and I put the training here, I do the evaluation, I feedback, I keep learning this process. During this feedback loop, if I put attack there, I put attacker here, then I can attack your training result. Then your training model is poisoned. Then your training model itself can be bad. Now, but that requires people internally, insider, to do the attack. But if you say, I'm not having this access, I'm just outsider, you can do attack too. So therefore, there are two types of attacks in the machine learning systems. One is insider attack, it's called the poisoning attack. One is called the evasion attack, which is I don't have access to the model, it's complete black box to me, but I actually can attack you, just use the whatever you can give to the public. I'm just probing it, query probing it. I will try to see it. So how the attack happened, I gave you a global view, then we look at the algorithms. Okay? Suppose I have a very simple classification task, cancer, not cancer. So, and these things are cancer, these are not cancer. So the decision boundary you can see is nonlinear. And now how do you attack? If I'm doing prediction-based attack, then what I do is I'm going to give you a point in this region. If I can find a image that actually falls into this region, and then I can actually add a little bit of perturbation, then make it across the border. So the moment it across the border, then becomes cancer. Okay, so the goal is you give me whatever image, I need to add some perturbation to move it across this decision boundary. If I can cross this decision boundary, bingo, then class becomes wrong. So the attack's goal is whatever the instance is real class, I want to change it. Okay, so if the class is no cancer, I'm going to change to cancer. Okay, if the class is cancer, I'm going to change to no cancer. So that's the attacker's goal. So now, if it's a poisoning attack, means during the training process, you're doing iterative training, insider training. So I'm going to try to see, okay, this is your real border. I'm going to change it by adding a few bad examples during the training process, by adding into your training data set. Now, because you're iteratively learning correcting errors, then you start changing your borders. Then I'm getting a bad model now. So whatever the model falls into this part becomes attack surface. Then you're dead. Okay, so that's all basically is a kind of attacks around decision boundary. But today, machine learning, nobody knows where is the decision boundary. Nobody knows. Why? Because it's hard. So the question is, nobody even knows what is correct decision boundary, because you based on the training data set, whatever you get is a decision boundary for that training data set, never for the future. But still, attacks based on that. So now, how you on the earth doesn't know anything derive decision boundary? Here's one example. I mentioned that the neural network just using this formula, weight x plus bias, right? So if you have a two class, minus and plus, then all you try to do is, okay, I'm going to define a function that is sign-based. If it's greater than zero, then it's a plus, otherwise minus. Then what you do is, you just find an example that is belong to plus, then find another example belong to minus. Then between these two, draw a line. Anything in between, keep drawing, keep trying. Trying until you hit, you know where it changes. And that is your decision boundary point. So basically, you can just use query probing to try to figure out where is that particular boundary between this negative and this plus, or this plus and this one. You just take any tool, you try it, you'll find here. Since the open public API, you allow me to do any query I want, I just keep querying it. But if you are smarter, then you don't query step by step. You can jump. Okay, you can develop a very smart query probing that make it very fast. You can find this boundary. You may not find the complete boundary. You'll find some boundaries. And once you find a few boundaries, now attack there. Attack there. How do you attack? Changing the probability to make the point that originally in here goes to there. Okay, that's what you do. So therefore, what is attack surface in this DNN attack? Is whatever is here. Because if this part is the spam, this part is no spam, then whatever decision boundary, zigzag, these are all pocket that you can attack. That's are the places you actually issue attacks. Okay, so there are so many attacks now in the literature, and there are hot areas, it's just too many. So what I'm gonna focus on, just black box prediction-based attack. Rest I'm not talking about, okay? So now, what is prediction level attack? Means evasion attack. So giving, I already have a model that's a black box to me. Giving an instance that I want to learn, what is the type? What is the label for this instance? So if the target is Y, I want to find the adversarial example, which means giving X, I add a little perturbation to X. Then I'm going to change the X's label to another one. So we formalize the attack. Attack means giving this model. You give me X, I'm going to change X to XADV. And then X label Y becomes YADV. And that's the goal. Now, that is how you can do it. Because this API is free. So what I do, you give me X, I take X, get a result. Then result come back, I know it's Y. Now I know it's Y, I don't want the Y. So I don't return Y. I'm gonna compromise here by changing X to XADV, feedback again, get back a YADV, then I return. Okay, so that's basically the attack process. Means I don't have to do anything, I just compromise the API. Where is the API set? Maybe in the cloud, maybe on your phone. And doesn't matter where it's set. If I compromise that, I can attack. Okay, so that's the whole process. Now, the entire machine learning community, AI community, they don't care systems research. All they care is, if I do attack, how do I attack? Okay, so now here, we are not talking about how they implement this attack. Think about it, in order to implement this attack, you have to compromise this thing. Okay, you have to compromise this thing. Without compromise this thing, you cannot do that. Okay, you have to compromise this. Now, here, let's come to see how they attack. They say, okay, this is the original image. I'm gonna perturb very little. I add a little noise. And the noise I add, human cannot see. But I change the probability value of this panda. to a closest animal. And happen to be in my learning process, closest animal is a gibbon. Even though they don't look alike, but in my probability calculation, they are close. So I just add this little probability. Now on the GUI, it's still here. But in real machine learning model, they think it's gibbon now. With 99.3 probability. So now, guess what? Then your attack is successful. So the entire attack is just finding this perturbation. Finding this little noise you can add and changes the probability distribution. Okay, so that's basically the attack. There are so many attacks out there, but there are three categories. The category one is called a fast attack, means one shot attack, no iterative learning. And the second one is a Jacobian attack, it's taking an image vision image techniques, Jacobian matrix, and using that to do attack. Okay, and then there are several different kind of optimization-based attacks. So I'm going to just talk about the first one and second one. But the first one is easy to understand, second one is a lot harder, because if you don't know Jacobian, you just go with whatever I can explain and to the best you can understand. Okay. So now this is a kind of what we talk about example. The self-driving car sees the stop, but you gave 100. What is that? Targeted attack. So means I want the stop to change it to a particular speed up sign and to get some accident, causes accident. And how do you do that? It's called a targeted attack. So now let's look at how on the earth you can do all these attacks. So before I do that, I want to say the attack is not on image only. For example, audios. You can change audios using same type of attack, and you change the entire audio voice into this. Totally different. So basically, a lot of things they can do attack. And by just adding perturbations, and you change to something different. Doesn't make sense, doesn't matter. Whatever the original sense is gone. Okay? So now let's look at the general attack principle. The general attack principle is very simple. Our goal is you have a real instance. You want to find another instance that's attack instance. There are differences, very, very small. Therefore, below the threshold. And the goal is the human cannot see. So goal is human cannot see. Now, another thing is I have to satisfy these three constraints. In addition, human cannot see. This constraint is very simple. The artificial crafted example is not in your data set. It's faked. Second is the class for this artificial example is a part of your class, just not equal to the X original source class. Okay, and then what is this function? This attack objective function, which is how do you attack it? You want a target to be random other label, just not this original one, or you want the label to be exactly the target. Then you have two kind of attack. One is a random attack, one is targeted attack. Random attack, you change the original class label to anything else, just not original one. And the targeted attack means I change the original label to a definite and deterministic class label. Now, of course, target attack takes more cost because it depends on which target you choose. Some target is easy, some target is harder. Okay. Now, untargeted attack, we call it a random attack, or in machine learning term, you call it a source class misclassification. Means the source class, you misclassify that, is error. Okay? But you randomly pick error to make it happen. Now, targeted attack basically means that source to target misclassification. Means you have a designated target. You want the source to change to that target, like a stop, change to 100. That's targeted attack. So the goal is different. This one is I want to maximize the distance between the real label that you learned and the fake adversarial learnable label that you want the user to see. So you want the distance to be bigger. Then you reach the attack. Now this one basically means that you want to minimize the distance between the adversarial examples label and the target label. Because you know what is target label. You just want these two to be very close. Why? Because by doing that, you're changing the weight by trying to close to this target label. Okay. So that's basically the whole principle. Therefore, entire attack, doesn't matter who invented, they are basically looking at OK, what is the threshold I want this perturbation to be? And what is the crafting rules? I want the data to be changed. How do I change the data? Okay, so this is the crafting rule. This is the threshold you crafted. Because even you change the perturbation, you don't want every time that the threshold is one, because that's too big. You want the theta to be small, so make the perturbation even smaller effect on the images or on the audios, so human cannot hear or see. So this is basically the one shot. Now if you do multi-step attack, means I don't know how to set the theta. So every time I change a little bit the theta, slowly going up, and then that is iterative attack. Now one shot attack, you have to guess the theta. So all the attack, actually, there is a magic here. If you do not know right theta, you cannot succeed attack, because you need really exactly right theta. And this one means I don't know theta. I'm going to start with very small and slowly add. And I will see when my attack is successful, I stop. So therefore, you use machine learning to train your model to attack. Okay, so that's basically the process. Now, this is a particular type of example how you do it. So this is called a fast sign, gradient sign method. So they are changing the gradient values of the attack. Because why? Because when you finish training, you remember I mentioned that every time you change the W, you climb on the hill. Now here, if you have a new image and the system doesn't know, you follow the rules, you have to do the same rule. Since if you are in the lower bottom of the mountain, you want to climb, there's two hills, then you need to decide which hill you go to go. And each step you only go slowly, and that's a rule. So therefore, every time you're slowly going in. And that's the process of you need to use the gradient here. So once you do this, then in the prediction layer, they're iteratively doing this, then you change that part. Okay, you change that part. So that's basically the reason why. Because you don't see the model, but this example image you have, and this image is following the rules to changing the weight in order to decide among the 10 labels which one I should be. What is my probability? So they still have to follow the rule. What is the rule? Take this image, take all the neurons, compare with each class neuron rule to see which one you are closer. So they are comparing that, right? They compare the distance between this new image with all the existing 10 class rules and try to figure out which one. And slowly, they are modifying the weight, try to climb to the right hills. So that causes attack. So that's why if most people using this tool, why? These are color images. This is a gray style and black-white images. And basically, they say all the attacks can be successful on these kind of images and these kind of images. Okay, so now how they do it? Let's just look at a little bit of problems. Because attack is not that easy to be successful. You need to tune. Now, all the papers using the best tuning to give you the attack success. But as a real life, you have to tune it. Okay, based on the image, based on things. I'm giving you the example. So here is an example. This is A1. And let me give you this example. Okay, this is the one. And then if you use a theta, the theta can be 005, 01, 02. Now you can see if I use a 02, I attack by changing 1 to 8. If I use 01, I change to 7. If I use 0.05, I didn't get a successful attack because the highest probability is still 1. This one highest becomes 7, this highest becomes 8. So you see, depends on how you set a theta, you do not know which one you get. And so now attacker has to be smart to set this, right? It's not easy. But if you set it right, it will attack you. Okay? Now next thing is, if you look at this thing, even with the same image, same perturbation, just a theta change, I get two different classes. They're not consistent. The attack's not consistent. So now think about how do you mitigate the attack? You utilize those kind of inconsistency, right? Think about this, okay? Now, let's see next one. So here is another one. This one, you see, is different than one. Two different images. But since this one using two is successful, I'm going to use two. Because the setting of theta is not per image based, it's per system based, per attack system based. So since I'm setting two, I'm going to use two here. now failed. I cannot succeed for this image. See, again, it's different. So means the attack responds to different image differently. So now think, how do you utilize that to do mitigation? Okay? So that's actually a very interesting result. So now if you look at the theta, you can see, of course, theta is bigger, then attack success is bigger. But for different digit, they are different. For different digit, they respond differently. Again, it's very interesting. Okay? So therefore means it's not that easy for an attacker to find one theta and it work for all the attacks. It's not that easy. Okay? So now next thing is, if you would set theta not too big, starting with iterative learning, here the theta, you can see the theta is 0.05. And here the theta is 0.02. But if I would start with very little, slowly learning it, I can use very little theta and to get a very high accuracy, much higher than this. So this accuracy is 86.5. And if I do theta starting with this, slowly adding it up, then I can get 93%. So it means if you use machine learning to learn how to set theta, you'll be more powerful. Now the question is, how do we mitigate that? Okay, think about this mitigation. Right now, no good mitigation, but there are quite a number of mitigations, but I want you to think about it. That's how to make a research interesting. So now let's see the next thing. Suppose I set theta to be 0.02 for MNIST data set. So now this line says all the images failed attack. You can see the failure is very small. They are all successful. So what it means that I take a 60,000 data set of entire data set belong to 10 classes, 0 to 9. And I try to perturb using the same algorithm perturb it with 0.2 as a theta. I try to attack. And it's random attack. Now you can see that for 1, for 0, it falls to 0, it's only this 0.068 percentage. Fall to 1, 0.018. And you can see the distribution. Total together is going to be 1. So if you look at these two lines, and look at this, so 99.5% success rate means I can attack 1 by using that attack randomly, and I will be changing 1 to anything else. And with 99.5% success rate. Now, if total number of images in my testing data set is 1,135, because MNIST data you can download, it's open source. That's this many for 1. And then I have about 1,128 that I attacked digit 1 successfully. But I have 6 images failed. 6 images failed. I don't know why, but the theta is not right. Okay? I cannot be 100%. Next thing is, if I attack 2, I only get 77% success rate. And among the total image I have is 1,032. That's from the data set. And then I have 796 successful attacked, but I have remaining 236 unsuccessful. Okay? So this also shows something interesting for mitigation. Think about how to mitigate. So that actually is very interesting. And then if you look at destination, the ones, the distribution very different. Say these most ones goes to here. 50% goes to 8. And others doesn't go. 50% go to 8 if I put the seat 0.2. Now if I put the seat differently, they may change. Okay, and that's another thing very interesting. So this is basically shows that if you characterize all the attacks, characterize what happens with this, then you can see a lot of things interesting. And this is basically targeted attack. Targeted attack, I'm going to pass quick because of time. Okay, because the algorithm for targeted attack is harder. So this shows if you do targeted attack by using theta and using the same attack method, not using Jacobian matrix. Jacobian matrix is powerful. This one is not. Then you can see how many digits you cannot target attack. If I want to 1 target to 0, I cannot do. To target 2, I'm successful with a theta equal to 0.3. But with 3, and with 3, theta is 0.3. With 4, 5, 6, I cannot do. Doesn't matter what theta I do, doesn't work. So you can see now, for target attacks, a lot harder. So the algorithm doesn't work. And that's why people start saying, okay, let's invent smarter algorithms. So these algorithms, very sophisticated algorithm, is today the most powerful algorithm for targeted attack, which is called the Jacobian-based attack. Okay, Jacobian-based attack using a pixel. Every time I change 2 pixels, if you have a pixel of 128 times 128 image resolution, every time I change 2. Okay, and I do every pair of 2, pairing them. That's a huge combination. I find the tool that is best for me to change. And what is best? That's a rule. There's a very sophisticated rule, but I'm telling you, A matrix is the cell that gave you, the 2 cells gave you the best way of changing it towards the target. And the B matrix is the best way to change it to any other class, but not target. Doesn't matter if it's target or not. So your goal is trying to optimize this tool. So this is a tool, like a ranking matrix. Then you are calculating pairwise pixels and get the rank. And then the number one ranked pixel, pair pixel, that's what you change. Okay, that's actually the matrix. What they change to largest value. Why? Because they use this matrix. Minus A means my goal is you reach A. Now, if you don't reach A, then I'm going to give you the highest value to push you to reach A. Okay, so that's basically the whole thing. Now, this is more complex, but you know, you just know that roughly the idea. Okay? So now I tell you the intuition. You see, intuition is when you start here and you give the original image, let's say X, then the label is here. So the value of probability you can see, one is very high, and everybody else is a little lower, like this. And something is really, really low. Now, after you did a 10-round iteration attack, because this attack has to do 10 steps, 10 iterative attack, you can succeed. After 10 iterations, you can see, now the line is all stuck together. Why? They change the gaps between probability. Original maybe is 1 is 0.85, 84. Everything is very small. Now, everybody, the probability is very close. Maybe fraction of very, very small differences as number one. And that's how they made the attack successful. So it means the moment I'm trying to reduce this probability, I'm going to increase everyone else. So eventually, the change would make the distance between all the probability become very close. Every step I do that. And then at the end, I'm going to change the source probability to a target probability. But during this process, everybody's probability going up. But I want a target one is number one. Now you see that's machine learning's fault, right? Because machine learning algorithm says, if you have a 10 probability, choose the highest one. Doesn't matter the second highest one, third highest one, how big the difference is. If the difference is a fraction of a digit after the period, after the decimal, 10 digits after decimal, doesn't matter. Still, pick the number one. So that is also a problem. That's why they take the opportunity to do this kind of attack. Okay, but this is what we live with, okay? So now let's look at here. So if you take a zero, you want to target attack to one, you see, target attack to two, you can do. And then you want to target next one to 8, you can do. You want to target next one to 7, you can do. But this actually, for each digit is different. So I'm choosing the top 3 easiest ones to do attack. Some of them even harder. So the probability is really, really, really small. That means if my target is this small, that means all the rest is going to be less than 0.31. All the rest will be less, because I'm the number one here. Okay, so that's actually the interesting things. Next thing interesting is, if you run different neural networks, neural network package, TensorFlow, Caffe, Torque, they respond very differently. They don't have the same response for the same attack. So it means you take a TensorFlow, you put a zero there, you want to attack to weight, they have a different success rate. Then you take Caffe, you take Theano, you take Tor. That's another very interesting thing. They don't respond the same way. So now if you say, I'm going to attack all the open source APIs that are all out there today, then you can see the success rate is very, very high. So basically, everything you can attack. You just do this, and all the attack code is in open source on GitHub. You can just download it, attack it. Okay, so now let's talk about mitigation quickly. Okay, I don't know how much time I'm going to be giving you the ideas. Okay, I have 10 minutes. I'm going to be just give you a few ideas. So the mitigation for the prediction part, I think for the training part, I'm going to skip because I don't have time. For prediction part of the mitigation, all it does is a stochastic a quantization. What that means, if you know the image compression, JPEG compression, basically they take the whole JPEG images, and then they take the a sub-matrix, the small pixel part, like a 2x2 pixel, 3x3 pixel, they compress it into one value. So the quantization, really, what the quantization does is a compression. Take a range of pixels and compress them into one value. You decide what is that one. You can do max, you can do mean, you can do zero, you can do the highest end. So you decide what is the value you want. You just compress everything into one value and reduce dimension. Okay, so that's basically quantization. Then you can have color-based, you have frequency-based. Now, color-based, the whole goal is I'm going to take the input, I'm going to use one model to generate adversarial attack. This attack is generated. And then I don't want to return to user. I want to detect whether this return label is attacked or not attacked. Then I'm taking two more models. These two models take this image. I quantize. I play the quantization. So it means I do feature squeezing. And if I do feature squeezing in different ways, then each feature squeezed result would be different with this label. If the difference is bigger than the threshold, attack. Don't trust this one. If it's not, okay, trust that. Okay, so the goal is I want to squeeze it. I want to change the image pixel in such a way that it would not affect the actual true label. It would also not affect the human's perception, but the attacker utilizing the image pixel relationship to change. Now I change the dimension of the pixel, I change the value of the pixel, now the attack goes away because it absorbed by those squeezing. That's the idea. Okay, lots of people have this idea. Okay, different ways they do this. So the whole goal is the following, very simple. So if the original image pixel value is 0.3, and if my perturbation is attacker's perturbation is 0.1, then basically all the 0.3 becomes 0.4, right? So if your quantization is anything below a half, 0.5 becomes 0. Everything above 0.5 become 1 because you quantize them by force them to either 0 or 1. Then good case is I'm going to force it to 0. So it's correct. Be correct 0.3. Doesn't matter how you add a perturbation. You're not increased enough to become 1. So bingo. So the attack is gone. It go back to where I was. Now, bad case is if you originally 3, but you choose perturbation 0.3, then you add up is 0.6. Now you force it to 1. Quantization made error. It helps you to be attacked. So that's why quantization doesn't work absolutely, but it works sometime. So that's state of art today. If you read all the quantization paper, doesn't matter, they do image JPEG compression, they do a pixel changing, they do a mean or median filtering, doesn't matter what they do. They all have some success rate, but they cannot completely mitigate the attack. They cannot. They don't even have the ability to do 90% mitigation because they do not know how to do this. But they are better than not mitigating it. They are better than not mitigating it. Okay, so that's actually funny. And then JPEG compression is a similar thing. Because you have an image here, you can do JPEG compression on the entire image. You can also do JPEG compression on each image pixel blocks. And because image has a different pixel condensation, color densitation, you can say, okay, user can give me the accuracy quality. Then I can vary these quantizations. And then you can do that. Once you do that, image compression techniques is so strong now, they can do all kind of transforms and give you that. Then you can just randomly pick this thing, or using user specified a range, randomly pick. Then you can do defense tool and have a similar result as feature squeezing. like the bit changing color, day step changing like the mean value. It's the same. So that basically says that how you do the defense. Okay, now for this part it's a lot harder. So I'm going to just give you one example since I have just 1 minute. So I don't have time to talk privacy probably. So PCA is known to be a dimension reduction techniques. So if you can change a large dimension into smaller dimension, then if the attack is done with a large dimension, then they lost. They lost. So what the student of mine did, the experiment is basically shows that if you have a dimension of 784 and then you change to 64, then original attack that geared for the 784, they are pretty much lost. So they are pretty much lost. So then you can actually gain accuracy much higher. However, it's not always true. Okay, for some data set, you get this high. Other data set, you don't. So therefore, it's still not solid solution. But the PCA is one problem. You need a training. You need a training phase. You need a training phase, training the system. Because you cannot do prediction-based protection. You have to train it and then use that. Okay, I have to end here because I'm not going to be able to talk about privacy anymore, but I want to mention one thing. There are membership-based attack in the system. So what is membership-based attack? Basically means that you do the training. Training is a secrecy, it's a private. But if you open the API to anybody to access, somebody can just probing your interface, knowing with a high probability that which instance that they probed is actually in your training data set. Therefore, leak the problem. And this part is also a severe attack. Basically, you take any probing instance, and you can give a high confidence with 90%, 99% that this instance must be in the training data set. Or some training data set must have this instance type that you train it. Now, how this is going to affect the whole thing, we do not know. But this is actually very severe attack. And the attack is also on the internet. You can actually download the code and try it. And these attacks are a lot more sophisticated than adversarial example-based attack. And they are actually generating attack models, attack instances, and doing a lot of work to do it. So you can actually play with it. So to close that, I'm going to just close that. So to close that basically means that privacy is an issue, security is an issue, trust is an issue. Because without the privacy and the security, we cannot trust. With our data, we cannot trust the model result. We cannot trust the users. Because what if the user is attackers? And we cannot actually do good collaborative learning with the federated learning. However, think about all the machine learning people look at algorithms. They forgot the entire system's security research, have done a lot of work. If that API cannot be compromised using any system techniques, there's no such thing about attack. There's no such thing about attack. If you cannot compromise that API, you cannot attack. So now, there are a lot of things that has not been explored because the entire study is from machine learning, from AI algorithm perspective to do the attack, to show the attack. There's no systems mechanism that has been studied for 30 years in this area yet. Because if you cannot compromise that black box API, you cannot do any of that. Okay, so I'm just ending here on the questions.